Now we come here in verse 24 to the subjective work of Christ for saints. And this is another division now from verses 24 through 29. That is the remainder of this chapter. He says here in our translation, who now rejoice in my sufferings for you, and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ and my flesh for his body's sake, which is the church. Now, if you want a free translation, I have it in my notes. Here it is. Now I, Paul, rejoice in the midst of my sufferings for you, and I am filling up in my flesh that which is lacking of the afflictions of Christ for his body's sake, which is the church. Now, Paul is saying here that it was necessary for him to fill up in suffering that which was lacking in the suffering of Christ. Isn't that a startling statement? Somebody says, well, that contradicts what you've been preaching, that he suffered for us and paid the penalty, and there's nothing that we are to do for salvation. And I still think that's true. In fact, I know that's true. But does this verse contradict it? No, my friend, this verse does not contradict it at all. Now, Paul was suffering in his body for the sake of Christ's body. Now, the implications here are that there was something lacking in the sufferings of Christ. It would seem that. And then the second implication is that it's necessary for Paul, and I think in turn for all believers, to make up that which was lacking. In other words, that suffering I must bear, he shares, and it completes his suffering. Now, that's rather startling because this is the epistle that we called attention last time that reveals the fullness of Christ. In him dwelleth all the fullness, the pleroma of the Godhead bodily. What a wonderful thing that everything is centered in him. How wonderful that is. And we saw that last time, that in all things that he might have the preeminence. And yet here, it would seem that there is something yet to be done. And Paul wrote in prison, by the way, says, I have fulfilled all of this. Now, you remember that there were two things that the Lord Jesus said to Ananias, the reason that he had saved Paul and was going to use him. First of all, he says he's a chosen vessel to me to bear my name to the Gentiles. And second, I'm going to show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And in prison, that's when Paul wrote, I fulfill this. I have done that. Now, I want to say right here at the beginning, in this very mooted verse, and I hasten to say it, the sufferings of Paul were not redemptive. There's no merit in his suffering for others or even for himself for his redemption. And Paul is very careful in the selection of words here. In other words, Paul was accustomed to speak of the redemption of Christ not as a suffering, but a cross, a death, and his blood. In other words, there's ministerial suffering and mediatorial sufferings. Mediatorial is the sufferings that Christ did for us. Now, we need to distinguish between the sufferings of Christ. And there are two general classifications, and there's a sharp distinction between them. And I want to make that today to try to clarify this passage of Scripture. There is that suffering which he endured, which cannot be shared. And there is the suffering of Christ, which he endured, which can be shared. Now let's look at the sufferings of Christ, which cannot be shared. Because there's a sharp line of demarcation between the two. Now, first of all, he suffered as a man. He was the Son of Man. The suffering that's common to humanity. When he, in his incarnation, 1900 years ago, born there in Bethlehem. And when he was born, I've often wondered, did he cry like other little babies that come into the world? I rather think that he did. And he was clad in the garment of that frail, flesh that you and I have. And in that flesh, he could get hungry, and he could become thirsty, and he was lonely, and he could suffer anguish and pain and sorrow, and he could go to sleep in a boat because he was weary and tired. And that is a human suffering. And we all have that. For every man must bear his own burden, Paul says. There are burdens that we must bear alone. We're born alone. He was. And feel pain alone. There are certain problems that you and I must face and face alone. There's a sorrow that comes. No one can share it with us. We become sick. No one can take our place. I remember when my daughter was just a little girl, we were crossing the desert coming from back east. It was the hot summertime, and we got into Arizona, and she'd been sick. And my wife took a fever, and we were alarmed. It had gone to 104. And we got her to the hospital there in Phoenix. And as she was lying there with that high fever, as I looked at her, I'd have given anything in the world at that moment if I could have taken her place. I'd have taken that fever gladly, but you can't do it. We can't share these things. And friends, there comes a time when you and I go down through the valley of the shadow of death. And humanly speaking, we're going to die alone. And that's the reason it's so wonderful to be a Christian and know that Jesus is with you at that time, because nobody else can go through that with you at that time. Therefore, he suffered as a man, as a human being. And then there's another suffering that he couldn't share. He suffered as the Son of God. He identified himself with God, and no other mortal has ever had to endure what he went through. He was made like unto his brethren, and he himself hath suffered, but he suffered as the Son of God. Now, I dwelt quite a bit when we were in the Psalms on Psalm 69 of how he was made the song of the drunkards in that little town of Nazareth. He suffered there. He said he made sackcloth his garment. Oh, what he suffered, because he was the Son of God. And then you remember they arrested him. And the soldiers of the high priest, they mocked him. They put a robe on him and a crown of thorns on him. Then they played a game, a Roman game, and it's known as hot hand. They blindfold him. Then all his soldiers would hit him with the fist. And then they'd take the blindfold off and ask him which one, because one would not hit him. And of course, he'd never guess the right one. They wouldn't let him guess the right one, even if he did. And then they would put the blindfold on again and play the game again and all pound him. The Lord Jesus Christ was marred more than any man. I think they'd beaten his face into a pulp when they put him on the cross. He suffered in a way that you and I never have had to suffer. And then there's another suffering he went through that no one can share. He suffered as the sacrifice for the sin of the world, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Now into this suffering, we cannot enter at all. We can appropriate his death as the fact that he took our place, but we can't enter into it. He alone went to the cross. He was forsaken of God and man. They put a crown of thorns on him, but they put that on others. But his was not the blood of martyrdom. It was the blood of a sacrifice. And in those first 3 hours, man did his worst at that time. And in the last 3 hours, God did his best. And in the first 3 hours, he's hanging on the cross from 9 to 12. It was light, and man was there. Then from 12 to 3 in the afternoon, the ninth hour, why, it was dark. And God was doing his best, because at that time, that cross became an altar on which the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world was there. And for Christ also hath once suffered for sin, the just for the unjust. Now, that's a suffering you and I cannot bear. He can't share that with anyone else. Now, there are sufferings of Christ which we can share. And that's what Paul's talking about here. I'm going to mention two. he suffered for righteousness' sake. In the synagogue yonder in Nazareth, in his own hometown, he says, "Now ye seek to kill me, a man that hath told you the truth." Just think of that. They sought to kill him because he was suffering for righteousness' sake. And he made the statement, "If ye suffer for righteousness' sake." And we're told very definitely, Paul writing to a young preacher in 2 Timothy 3:12, "Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." May I say to you, if you today are going to live for God, if you are going to take a stand for the right and for God, you'll find out that you'll be passed by. Many men are passed by today in the distribution of earthly honors. And God's man, the world will damn you with faint praise, and they'll praise you with faint damns. That's the way the world treats God's man today. And when I see how certain athletes are lauded and praised, and certain in the entertainment world are praised, and certain politicians are praised, and certain professors, but God's man today, my friend, is not praised. You'll suffer for righteousness' sake if you stand for the things that are right in this world. And Paul could say in Romans 8:36, "As it is written, for thy sake we're killed all the day long, we're counted as sheep for the slaughter." That's the position you'll take if you stand for him. And then the second type of suffering that we can share is we shall suffer in the measure in which we identify ourselves with Christ. John in 1 John 4:17 said, "Because as he is, so are we in this world." And the Lord Jesus made it very clear in John 15:18. He says, "If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me. And if ye were of the world would love its own. But you're not of the world, and the world will hate you." The popularity of the Christian with the world is an inverse ratio with his popularity with Christ. My friend, if you're popular with the world as a Christian, you're not popular with Christ. And if you're going to be popular with Christ, you're not going to be popular in this world. And the child of God today is to take his place, identify himself with Christ. You remember that the Lord Jesus today suffers through his church. Remember, he said to Saul of Tarsus, he said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?" And this young Pharisee, Saul, was startled and puzzled. He said, "What do you mean? I'm not persecuting you, I'm persecuting these Christians." But he was persecuting Christ. And Peter could say in his epistle, 1 Peter 4:12, "Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial that shall try you, but rejoice inasmuch ye are partakers of his suffering." And may I say to you that he suffered as a human being, but that was not his redemptive death upon the cross. These are things you and I can't enter in. But there's one thing that is for sure. If the gospel is to go forward today, somebody must suffer. I remember hearing the late Dr. George Gill put it like this. He said, "You know, when a child is born in this world, some woman has to travail in pain. And the reason," he said, "that there are not more people being born again is because there are not enough believers willing to travail." This is not popular today, but that's what Paul is talking about. All of us would love to see revival, and we talk glibly about witnessing and about living for God and all that sort of thing. My friend, may I say to you, if the gospel is going to go forward today and people are going to be saved, somebody is going to have to pay a price. I wonder how much you're paying today to get the word out.